things weren't going the way I thought they were. I ended up with the two babies by 20. I was on social assistance, and I realized, my God, you know, this isn't what I thought my life was going to be. I thought I had many opportunities. And I was sitting there with my grandmother, who was about 94, and I was very depressed over the fact that this is what my life was like, and the poverty and the violence and all those things that are associated were all around me. And I looked to her and I said, tell me something. I need to hear anything. Tell me something. And she sat quietly and she said, well, I'm very, very old, and I'm getting ready to go to my grave. And she said, I don't regret the things that I have done, but what will haunt me to my grave are those things I did not do. And that moment, I knew that I had to do something to change what natural statistic I was becoming as a Native woman.
The demand for a different kind of business world, a different kind of social world, is enormous. And it's a demand that is largely being driven by events in the United States, events that we have to know about.
I think that being in the States taught me how to really move things in a more savvy way that is going to be, you know, not just palatable for decision makers, but really can educate, inform decision makers so that they can make the right decision.
For business in North America, yes, we've got the trade agreements, we've got the banking structures, we've got all of the mechanics of a good trading relationship, a good, intimate, integrated management operation. You know what we don't have? We don't have a deep appreciation of who we are as people. And unless we get that, unless we get that emotional connection of country to country, what we're going to find is, gee, the Canadian operation doesn't work very well. I keep sending American managers there and they want to come home.
What we're in fact looking to do is to develop better understanding between the two communities or the two countries. And better understanding can result in better cooperative relationships when issues that are divisive arise. And I think what the Fulbright Program does is it enables leaders in the community to have that better understanding from both Canada and the United States.
What the Fulbright experience gave me is a greater understanding of Americans, but also a greater understanding of Canadians and of where we fit into the continental scheme, but also into the larger world scheme.
I went to Harvard Law School for one specific reason. There's a school of thought that's called Critical Legal Studies, and I was fortunate enough to study with one of its founders. And I used the Fulbright at the time to work on trying to understand better my legal culture as a French Canadian in relationship to this particular school of thought. And with that in mind, I used it as a filter to understand better a part of the history of French legal thought.
The fact that they supported my work with elders to learn from them is relevant to the very work that I'm doing today, which is to try to take that acknowledgement to a higher level so that, I guess, globally people understand that there are knowledge systems outside of the Western system.
The message that was always told to me by my high school teachers was that, with all the best intentions, it was that university was really out of bounds. It wasn't sort of to be for me. So I never really even thought of university. It was never on my radar screen until quite later in life and right after high school. I ended up taking a job as a laborer.
Sometimes it amazes me that a program as prestigious as a Fulbright would capture people like me, because, you know, the Fulbright has this really incredible and really sort of a prestigious reputation, and here I was, like this little immigrant kid. So that was what it was about me then, you know, on a personal level. It was about, you know, setting out to do what I could to make sure that immigrants and minorities and people who are really marginalized in society would have a more receptive and understanding, compassionate environment in which to contribute to society.
I started at the University of Saskatchewan, and I was 27 years old. And the first class that I took in anthropology, I had a quiz, and that quiz was worth 1% of my grade, and I managed to get 4 out of 10. And I thought, okay, I'll just quit because I'm not good enough to be here. And this is, it may sound very, very trivial. And my professor said, you know, it's 1% of your grade. It's not the end of the world. You can do this. But I think, and this is why I think in terms of Métis people, but also in terms of people who grew up in impoverished situations, that this is, entering academia is entering a whole new world for us. It's a whole new culture, new language. When I started university, I had to look up the word metaphor to find out what it meant as I read this book. And so receiving this 4 out of 10, which sounds like a negative thing, and was something that I literally was going to quit and go back to work. And my professor said to me, hang in there a bit longer. And then what happened is that I started to do well.
Those gates of university finally opened up to me, and I never looked back. I ended up seizing that opportunity and doing exceptionally well, and ended up getting a scholarship to the London School of Economics, and that ended up in this wonderful career with the Canadian government, and then on to Harvard as a Fulbright scholar.
It's extremely important, fundamentally important for business leaders to contribute to the Fulbright program. We now have a track of 10 years of scholars going off to the United States and coming back to Canada, and they are in the professions, in the academy, in the sciences, in all walks of life.
There's no way on earth that we could get that experience unless we received the support from something like a Fulbright Fellowship. And when I say something like, there aren't something like the Fulbright Fellowship. I mean, they're very unique. There are very few opportunities that will in fact provide appropriate funding that will give the real opportunity to students to get that international experience.
Support a Fulbrighter, and then don't just throw the money at them and hope that it all works out. Bring them back. Bring them to your head office. Have them talk to your managers. They may not be policy wonks, they may not be business students, but they're going to bring you a level of insight, and you need it. You may not think you need it, but you need it. And you can't get it out of a book. You can't get it out of a tape that's advertised in the airline magazine as you fly on Air Canada. What you need is a human understanding, and it's not going to come any other way. And this is the smartest way I know to get it, because not only are you doing good for your firm, not only are you doing good for your long-term operational viability, but you're also doing good for people.
Our primary partners, political partners, social partners, but most importantly, economic partners, are in the United States. And understanding what they're doing, what they're going through, what challenges they're trying to meet are going to make us better able to be part of that environment.
I know they say that knowledge is power, and it really, really is. And it gave me the opportunity to just open up all these places. A title of doctor, that's not important to me. What's important to me is that I think that my education will help me to grow to be a wise old woman.
To this day, I tell young people that, you know, it's up to you. Nobody's going to come in and do it for you. So we have to take that first step.
The world is changing very dramatically. We have to change with it. We have to see how other people change with it. And then we have to fit that into a sort of new conception of the world.
Fulbright is crucial because it helps to really transform us to the kind of level of understanding, the kind of depth that we're going to need if we're going to make this relationship work for another 200 years.
People have different terms and they have a different language for wanting to do good. It doesn't sound the same way as how we phrase it in Canada, but they're coming from the same place in their heart.
For me, the more important value was the effect it has on your larger understanding of yourself and of your people and how we differ from Americans.
The Fulbright brought us together. We continue to work together to assist each other and borrow good ideas and best practices working in other countries.
Pick anything in the world you want to study, tell me about it, and you know we can sponsor it. And that I think is a great and exciting way to have a scholarship.
It affords so many people so many opportunities to experience life and development in these other worlds.
It's this chain that you just try to keep on rejuvenating by having young students. I feel not only follow some of your footsteps, but do their own thing. And also, I want them to go further. I want them to be better than I am, and then to have themselves, young people, looking up to them and also being there for them and making them achieve their own dreams.